This month, the government has announced the biggest shakeup of immigration policy in the last 40 years. The new system will supposedly end migration of unskilled workers from outside the EU. But for these African illegal immigrants, it won't make the slightest difference. Last September, over 1,000 of them stormed the fence that surrounds Ceuta, a piece of Europe in Africa. This is the front line of Fortress Europe. Every year, thousands of Africans flee their continent in search of a better life. But it's a dangerous journey. Many have died. Britain and Europe want to keep these Africans out, blocking their every move and forcing them underground. I want to understand what this means for those who attempt this journey. I will join the immigrants hiding in the Moroccan forest, and I'll attempt to live as they do, smuggling myself from Africa to the UK. They have never allowed journalists access before. I must go under the cover of darkness to avoid detection.
I've just been dropped by the camera crew. I'm supposed to meet a group of people here. Some of them are around already. I'm supposed to meet, I think, Austin, who is my contact. Who is Austin?
Yeah, it's me, Austin.
Right.
Mr. Sam, yes. We have to leave this place because this place is not made for us. We have a street, we have a forest.
Man, this place. Let's go. This is like a baptism of fire.
Off the torchlight,
You guys are panicking. They're shaking and it's really dark. I'm a bit scared to say the least.
They call themselves the Camarades, and they live deep in the forest, a two-hour walk from the Straits of Gibraltar. I'm not allowed to offer them any assistance. My role is to observe.
I honestly don't know where I'm going. And I put my life in the hands of these guys. I trust them. Well, they said I should trust them. Okay.
These eight Nigerian Camarades allow me to stay at their camp. I wondered why they were here. Kizito left home 5 years ago. He told me he'd been in this forest since 2002.
Life goes on, brother.
Exactly.
That is why we are here today. That is why I'm here. I graduated in 1998 with a degree, BA degree in philosophy. For 3 years, I tried to get a job for myself. I couldn't get any job. So I have to go somewhere else where I can make a better living and so I can take care of myself, take care of my family. If I get to that Europe, that is great. I am ready to do any kind of job. So far I'm being paid a good money, you know. If you want me washing the toilet, washing the bathroom, or washing the train station, the train track, I will be very happy. Forget I'm a graduate.
Kizito lets me sleep in freezing, wet and cramped, but I'm happy to have some shelter.
Gosh, last night was really, really horrible. You know, after that hellish walk, the last thing I had anticipated is to come and sleep in this tiny, tiny tent with three full-grown men, all of us breathing at each other.
This group of Camarades are just some of the thousands who have gathered in this forest. Their aim is to break into the Spanish enclave, Ceuta, a part of Europe in Africa. This highly militarized zone is protected by an 8-kilometer-long, 6-meter-high fence topped with razor wire to keep the Africans out. We are in Africa. But just the other side of that fence is Europe. It's agonizingly close. Theo, a business student, simply wants to escape.
In Africa, there is war, there is hunger, there is diseases and other things. So I believe that in Europe, in Western world, you will find a betterment there.
Theo said he left home after his five brothers died of starvation. He spent 4 long years on his desperate journey.
Don't you see how I'm living now? You cannot see my, don't you see my house? We are sheets. Even shit is better than us. If I may say, shit is better than us.
The comrades build their tents as close to the fence as they dare, using whatever they can lay their hands on.
Hotel La Bouche, no pay. There's no house rent here.
And there's no security either. The comrades are always on their toes, fearing American police raid.
You know, this place we are, it's not safety guarantee because anything can happen.
Ali,
police, the gendarme, they can just walk into the forest
and
chase or destroy everything.
Come around now, come around.
What is that?
For these guys, it's a game of cat and mouse. If the authorities catch you, they will deport you to the Algerian border. That means at least another 2 week trek back to the forest.
The police, there are so many, more than 100.
Clearly, the gendarmes are around, they are in the bush, and we are all gonna quickly pack our things together and just get ready to be on the run, because this is more or less what the life of these guys are, always on the run.
For 2 hours, we have to wait in silence for the all clear. It's a stressful ritual they have to go through every day.
Everything seems to be conniving against these immigrants. The authorities are forcing them deeper and deeper into the forest, making these people live like rats, all crammed in holes.
I'm beginning to understand why these people are prepared to risk their lives to get out of this mess.
We don't have newspapers, no radio, not even a television. But we know today is Christmas. We just want to thank you. I'm hoping my family, my wife, my 3 kids, they are having a better Christmas.
I thank you, Lord, for all those that are celebrating Christmas around the world. And I know from my distance, are watching over us here in the forest. Though we don't have anything to celebrate the Christmas, we thank you, Lord, for the air that we breathe.
Christmas is an especially tough time for those on the journey. I'm missing my kids terribly, and I've only been here 5 days. Heaven knows how Austin feels, who hasn't seen his twin daughters and son in 4 years. He doesn't even have the money to call them on Christmas Day. Is this the season of goodwill? For the comrades, the message from Europe this Christmas is all too clear. For Africans, there's no room at the inn. Today, Theo and Gus are attempting to break into Europe. They call it striking. Climbing over the fence was a traditional way in, but with increased security, the comrades have had to come up with a new idea. Theo and Gus are going to swim to Europe. They need to negotiate the powerful currents, swim around the fence into Ceuta, and avoid the Spanish military police on the way. Both have paid a Moroccan contact 250 euros for wetsuits and guidance through Moroccan security.
Samura, this is the jacket I want to use to travel over to Spain. I've got all my material completed. I hope that the sea will be calm so that I will move today. Being 28 December, the 28th December, I want to spend my new year over there.
You scared about tonight?
Of course I'm scared. I'm scared of whatever.
Later, we walk to the beach where Gus and Theo put on their wetsuits. They'll have to swim for over an hour if they are going to make it. Hundreds die attempting to get into Europe each year, and no one had made it over this way in the last 6 months. But for Theo and Gus, the risk of death is not enough to stop them. I can't go across with them as I can't swim. So I see them off at the water's edge.
Morocco. Stay safe.
No problem.
God bless. Wow. Careful, young man.
On the walk back, I can't help thinking it doesn't matter what barriers we put up. The sea could be electrified, but I'm convinced these people would still keep trying.
I just pray to God that they'll make it safely to the other side. Because these guys have endured a lot, and I believe they deserve better.
In Ceuta, our camera crew is waiting for the camarades' arrival. But so is the Spanish Guardia Civil. One of the camarades manages to get through and is washed up on the rocks. But we are stopped from filming. News comes through that it was Theo who made it. The other three were caught by the Moroccans and immediately deported to the Algerian border.
Okay, guys.
I'm 10 days into my journey traveling as an illegal immigrant from Morocco to the UK. It's time to leave the camarades. I can't understand why these people are being forced to live here like animals, a life that's worse than the one they've left behind. Everyone treats them as criminals, yet all they dream of is a menial job in Europe. I rejoin my crew and travel to Ceuta. I need to find out what's happened to Theo. This Spanish outpost in Africa has a population of 76,000. The fence surrounding this enclave was only constructed 6 years ago to stem the flow of immigrants coming in. And the reason they try is because once inside, they are subject to European immigration laws. I wondered how Theo would adapt to this new environment.
Wow.
I thank God in all things.
I thank God in all things.
I was not sure that you would make it. I kept praying for you.
That is, I don't know that God will help.
I'm so happy to see you on this side.
That is the beach. And other things.
Is that where you landed?
No. It's more far from there.
You look at those hills.
Yeah. Those hills, yeah.
And you just think, just three or four days ago,
yeah.
You were in that bush.
Yeah.
Your friends, they're all there.
Stuck there.
Have you managed to talk to them?
Not yet, but after. I can be because of financial aspects.
It's amazing. This is it's a tough story to take on. Really,
Africans who make it here are taken to the government's holding center where they receive food and shelter. Most conceal their true nationality, picking a war zone as their home country in the hope of gaining asylum in Europe. The process can take 2 to 3 months. In the meantime, the priority is to find work. Theo's new friend, Kennedy, tells us how to earn some money.
There's a place we go to the immigrant. The park very well. They give us money.
Kennedy takes us to try our luck parking. It's desperate and almost impossible to earn any money. I can see these guys really do want to work, but they're trying to create jobs where there are none. Theo also seems lost and confused in his promised land.
It's absolutely tough. I mean, there seems to be no chance for newcomers.
Very, very tough.
We'll just hope that we're lucky next time.
It's going to take Theo a couple of months to get to the mainland. But surprisingly, he is one of the lucky ones. Kennedy wanted to show me a derelict factory known as the Longhouse. The squat is home to illegal immigrants on the run. The people here have been identified or suspected of being Nigerian, one of the few countries that has a deportation agreement with Spain.
People use it as a toilet, and people living shit for it. It's hard to describe the smell. This is... this is horrible.
I am surprised that anyone can live here in these conditions.
How do you survive in this place? No food, no heating system.
Begging for food.
You beg for money. If you don't do that, there's no way for you.
Do you get harassed by the police?
They call me a couple of times.
How do they behave? How do they treat you?
Everybody starts running, you run. Because nobody knows what's going to happen next.
If you are caught, you can't be deported. You
understand? You have to run.
You have to keep running.
It's like the race we started right from Africa. It doesn't stop.
These people choose to leave their homes and families in search of work. But their journey to Europe ends here in the hellish limbo at the Longhouse. I wonder if it's really worth it. Today, I'm leaving by ferry, heading for mainland Spain. As many immigrants lie about their nationalities, the Spanish government doesn't know where to deport them to. They can't stay in Ceuta. There isn't room. So after 2 months, they are given an expulsion order and a ferry ticket to the mainland. When they arrive, just like me, with no money, having only their clothes on their backs, they are free to disappear into Europe.
The further you get into this journey, the lonely you become. Now my crew more or less waved goodbye. They give me 10 euro and I'm hoping that I'll be able to beg around and see how much I can raise so that I can get something to eat tonight. 50 cent, 1 euro. Hola, 1 euro.
No.
Something to eat? Hungry?
This is demeaning. You begin to feel inferior very quickly. I can't imagine what months of this would be like.
Okay.
After 2 hours, I make a breakthrough.
Good man. Thank you very much. Thank you. What's your name?
Tommy.
Tommy totally rescued me. He could see how desperate I was and decided to help me out. He took me to the market and begged for me. He went straight to the African stallholders to ask for money. Tommy said those who have done the journey before know how hard it is. They do whatever they can to help their fellow Africans.
15 euro, 16 euro.
60 euros.
16 euro. You understand?
Yes, yes. Thank you so much.
Okay, now bye, eh?
Thank you.
See you later.
Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.
I cannot believe Tommy's generosity and patience for a stranger. If it weren't for him, I'd be stuck here for a lot longer. I now have enough money for my train fare north. On my travels, I've been given the name of a contact in Barcelona. He might be able to arrange to have me smuggled into France. Barcelona is one of the main staging posts for immigrants heading north to the UK. When I get there, I'll have to survive for a few nights before my passage can be arranged. It's a daunting prospect to arrive in a strange city, not speaking the language, with no money in your pocket.
I don't have a clue where I'm going at the moment, but...
I know now that what you do when you arrive in a new city is to approach the first black face you see.
But do you know somewhere where I can sleep? I don't have money.
Who could I want to sleep? Like in the back, you see some people want to sleep?
Yes.
It's open place. At that kind of place you can sleep. When you're open, you sleep, no trouble.
What, in the morning? In the bank?
Yeah.
The first bank I try is very busy. In the second one, I don't know what the man is doing, but he won't let me in. Eventually, I find a place to lie down.
God, this guy really screams. Is this what we're killing ourselves for?
What an introduction to Europe.
The next morning, I meet up with my contact, Tony. He doesn't want to be identified and says it will take a few days to arrange my travel. In the meantime, he agrees to show me how to earn some money. Many illegal immigrants buy cheap goods from markets, which they sell on to tourists for a small profit. Today, we buy batteries and head to the selling patch, La Ramblas, the main tourist area of Barcelona. It's totally depressing. I've been here 4 hours and haven't sold a single battery. I return later and try my luck with flowers.
Is that there are no lovers in this place, or is it just that they don't want to help immigrants? Señor, uno por ahí, 3 euros. Gracias. 6 euros. Gracias.
I've been walking for hours and have less than 2 euros to show for it. It must take illegal immigrants months to raise the money to move on. This is rock bottom. I need to get out of here. I can't face another night sleeping rough with these desperate people. For me, this seems worse than the bush. Tony says he knows a man who can get me into France. We meet with Innocent, a Nigerian smuggler. He's taking 2 customers tonight on one of his border shuttle runs. There's 1 space, and if I trust him, then I think I might take it.
How safe is it gonna be for me?
They have to make sure, sir, I take you there without no police problem. There's not going to be problem, I guarantee you of that.
And how long do you think it's gonna take?
Let's say 2 hours, more or less, 2 hours.
So 2 hours will be in France?
2 hours time will be in France, leave it alone.
Well, by car, how much would it cost me?
It's not going to cost you much. 700 to 800 euros.
Well, I think I'm up for the journey.
Okay.
Thanks.
Congratulations.
I told you it will be easy.
That's true. Yeah. I'm just hoping that I will be able to make it as well further to London, because it's really difficult, this place, being in this place.
The crew paid a 700 euro fee. God only knows how long I'd have to beg or how many flowers I'd have to sell to raise that amount. We drive to a supermarket to pick up one of Innocent's other passengers. Peter had also come through Morocco. It has taken him 3 years to make it this far. For the last few months, he has been sleeping here in this car park.
Where about have you been sleeping?
That is the place I'm taking you guys, sir. I slept around there, I put some things here. Put carton, you know.
Carton,
I
yeah.
open it, I put it in the ground. Yeah. That is how I survived my mice.
But Peter, why would anyone want to go through this, you know, to come and put themselves through such very, very tough life, sleeping out in the cold? I'm pretty sure back home, you know, it wasn't that bad.
Fact is that none of us, when we were born and brought up in a kind of situation, you find yourself like me, and I was not, you know, born and brought up with a silver spoon.
You must have struggled to raise 600. Yeah. How did you raise it?
Begging, I do begs in the streets.
And okay, so
we need safe journey.
All right, okay. Get in.
Okay. I really don't know what to expect. Peter and I have put all our faith and money in Innocent's hands. He passes us over to his driver, Joseph. We take back roads and wait for the all-clear signal from the scout car ahead. We cross the border. There's no sign of the police. We arrive in Papillon with relative ease. However, there is an unpleasant surprise waiting for us. Peter tells me off camera that Innocent and his driver promised that I would get him to England.
I'm not gonna change my mind.
Okay, good. Of course they lied. But this shows the dog-eat-dog world I'm now part of, where fellow Africans are selling each other out. It's a rude awakening for me.
Listen to me, my friend. I'm not listening to you. You are not my friend. You are the sort of people who are corrupt in Africa. You are the sort of people who are making people like this suffer. Genuine people. You are wicked. You are the people who are destroying the continent. People like you.
Peter is angry with the smuggler. If I was him, I would be angry too. He's been conned out of what little money he had, and he's now stranded here in France. It's time for me to leave. I need to be more careful from now on. I am heading for Calais, the final staging post for the UK.
How am I gonna do this? Bloody hell, they pee in this place.
It's another night sleeping rough, surrounded by the stench of urine. I don't have any money, but I'm definitely getting on that train tomorrow. Today, I begin the final push as an illegal immigrant heading to Britain. I need to get to Calais, and with no money, I will attempt to ride the train as far as I can. I'll hide in the toilet for as long as possible. It's a ridiculous situation, but it's the only realistic way of getting anywhere as an illegal immigrant.
Someone goes straight to open the door. Don't know where that cigar is. Every time the door goes, it scares me. It's like your heart misses a beat.
I got caught without a ticket a third of the way to Calais. The crew buy my ticket for the rest of the journey. But it's feasible an illegal immigrant wouldn't have to jump many trains to get here. At Calais train station, I meet some fellow immigrants. It's not hard as there are plenty of them. They show me the way to the African encampment, just a short walk out of town, in the woods behind the ferry terminal. I've traveled over 1,000 miles in 4 weeks, but this feels like I'm walking back into the forest of Morocco all over again.
Salam alaikum.
Where do you come from?
I'm from Sierra Leone.
Sierra Leone.
Yes. And you?
I'm Sudan.
Oh, from Sudan.
Yeah.
Arik, a young Sudanese guy, invites me into his tent. Even though the Songhat Center shut 4 years ago, many immigrants still remain, living rough in these woods.
How many people live here?
All people. All people from here.
That's 450. Like 400 something.
400 something.
Yeah.
What sort of people live here?
Sudanese, from Somal as well.
Eritrea.
Subia. Sudan.
Nigeria, Nigeria, in Ghana.
Five, six person.
What about Iraqis?
Yeah, there is a lot. Kurds, Afghanistan. The other nationality we don't know even.
After my journey, I'm exhausted and sick. Arik offers me shelter in his tent for a few nights. Morning light reveals just how close the woods are to the port. Trucks with produce bound for the UK stream past continually. For the immigrants who've made it this far, the emotional impact of the journey is beginning to take its toll. Many are stressed, angry, and confused. Arik tells me why.
You see, since I've been here, and this place, 17 days, no shower, no proper food, no place to stay, there is rain, there is snow, it's very cold here. And therefore, you got shut down, pam, and you died. But here, you died step by step. You die like this. You get crazy until you die. And you spend the whole life like this, in the forest, and you trying. Your whole life, you just going crossing the border illegally. Like a dog life, really.
The Calais comrades rely totally on food handouts from a distribution point across town. They have to take the back routes, and I film secretly as Arik tells me they are constantly harassed by the French police.
See, sometimes the police, they cross by this way, okay, yeah. And by the other way, at the end of this line.
Yes, the train line.
Yeah, train line.
They then block.
Yeah, they block by this way and by the other way. And if, even if you run, you find them in front of you. Like this, they catch people.
Food is distributed by Christian charities from a beaten up shed in wasteland near to the port. It seems like all the nations of the world are here. The English Channel is the last barrier illegal immigrants have to somehow cross to reach their final destination, the UK. The scenes of desperation here are truly staggering. This isn't Ethiopia, Somalia, or Sudan. This is Calais. This is 25 miles from Britain. It's a brutal and humiliating experience.
The food is better than all the other days.
Normally day, one bread and one piece of cheese.
That's all.
That's it.
One bread, one
there
cheese.
There is no water. The water over there.
That's the water that you drink. Jesus.
Everyone here, without exception, is heading for the UK. It has an almost mythical status amongst illegals. It is easy to make connections and disappear. They also believe they are treated better by the authorities in the UK than in other European countries.
How long have you been trying to get across to London?
We try every day, every night.
So are you going to try again tonight?
Yes, yeah, tonight, every night. Every night we try.
Well, I will try as well. Let's see.
That's good.
Well,
so we try together.
Jump inside the port and...
Bye.
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 Okay. I see you in London.
Arik and his friends are convinced work and a better life awaits them in the UK. He told me that the Channel Tunnel was now too risky to try. We will attempt to cross by hiding in lorries bound for the UK. First, we must enter the port. We take Arik's friend, James, with us. He will make sure the lorry door is closed once we are inside. The port is a highly controlled area. There are CCTV cameras everywhere and regular police patrols. However, all the immigrants know the blind spots and we move with ease to the parking area. It doesn't take long before we find a truck destined for the UK. We have to wait in silence, not knowing when the lorry would leave or if we would make it through the three customs checks. After 4 hours, we hear noises outside. The police are checking the vehicle with heat-seeking equipment. We hold our breaths, hoping not to be detected. We are caught. No one bats an eyelid. It's all in a night's work for the police, and Arik knows the routine well. We were taken to the police station where we were separated. I'm released after I identify myself as a journalist. I head back to the woods as I wanted to discover Arik's fate. I'm worried as the guys told me it's a lottery as to what happens to you when caught. Sometimes you're released, sometimes you're detained, and sometimes you are driven to the German border and told to leave. The woods seem abandoned. I just hope there hasn't been a police raid.
There's absolutely no one here. I wonder what would have happened to Arik. I'll go check in the feeding place.
There's no sign of Arik, and I need to continue my journey. Among the illegal immigrants at food distribution, there are Kurdish smugglers. They are immigrants themselves, but make their money by hiding others in lorries. They know the port inside out, and you have a better chance of getting through. I have to pay 500 euros. An amount of money that would take months for an immigrant to raise. That evening, my contact guides me to a holding area.
You are here, sleep.
Okay. Shukran. Thank you. Thanks, shukran.
What is Arabic?
It's more English.
English. Africa, you
mean? Me, Africa.
Okay.
Sierra Leone.
Okay.
You?
Iraqi.
Iraq.
My friend.
Yes?
Come. You're right?
Yes. All right.
No cold?
Cold.
Okay.
The Kurdish smuggler starts a lament. And to my amazement, around 30 other illegal immigrants of all different nationalities emerge from the woods. They are all paying customers too. Tonight is a busy night, and they organize us into different ethnic groups. I'm led to a two-carriage truck. The smugglers break into the back whilst the driver is sleeping in the cab. A space is prepared for me. I'm told to remain still and not move until the driver starts the engine. Five hours later and I haven't moved an inch. I'm freezing cold and my back and legs ache. It's terribly uncomfortable and I'm not sure how much longer I can hold out. Finally, after 8 hours, the lorry passes through customs unchecked and I make it onto the ferry. The lorry has stopped at a warehouse somewhere near Northampton.
Gotta climb out there, chap. Let's go.
Thank you.
When I am discovered, the police are called. If I were an illegal immigrant, I'd be held until immigration officials arrive.
Thank you very much.
They would assess my case, and in all probability, I'd be deported and have to start my journey all over again.
Sorious, my asylum is Samura.
Have you got your ID, please?
Yeah.
How long have you been on that lorry then?
I got in 2 in the morning.
Mm-hmm. You're a British national?
Yeah, I'm a journalist.
I don't know, what things you guys get up to?
After I identified myself as a journalist, I was quickly released. That night I received a call from Arik. He's made it over and has been sleeping rough in the Manchester area. I'm desperate to discover how he made it.
Arik, my man.
Come on. I do it, my man.
You're right.
Great man.
You did it.
You did it.
Destination.
London, yeah, that's it.
Destination London.
But I brought
well,
you here.
Exactly, but this is not yet London.
Tell me about the story, man. What happened?
Okay, when they saw my paper and then they say, okay, go.
Ali.
And they say, Ali. Yeah. I look around, so there's nobody, no control,
no,
nothing.
None.
So I'm just running
yeah.
into the vehicles,
yeah.
to the truck.
Yeah.
So I get down under,
underneath.
Under the truck. When he came out from the ferry, he just driving. He doesn't stop.
You were still underneath that vehicle.
You see, I'm like this.
Under that vehicle.
Yeah.
Driving through the streets of England.
Yeah. About maybe, I think 7 hours.
What?
7 hours.
You could have died for this country?
But I think it's...
Well...
It's very difficult and we suffer so much, too much like this to get in.
But my friend, welcome to your dreamland. What? You make me feel like mine was nothing.
A month later, Ari calls me with news that he has been told to leave the country. I wanted to see what his next move would be. On the drive up, I can't help but imagine there's an immigrant in every one of these trucks. Up until now, Arik has been housed by the government in Wigan and given a small allowance for food.
Hello?
Hello,
how are you?
How are you?
Good to see you again, man.
So, this is all my stuff. This is the final decision that I have received.
Your application for asylum has been refused and fully determined.
Yeah.
You will be allowed to stay in the accommodation until 27th February 2006, which is today.
Today, yeah.
So that means you have to leave this place today.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do now?
I will leave the house and
We'll see.
Seen here.
He finally admits he's actually been deported twice before. He came via Libya and was smuggled to Italy. In both countries, he was in prison for being an illegal immigrant and has spent almost 6 months in jail. This time, he's determined to stay illegally if he has to.
How are you going to find jobs and means of making money? What are you going to do?
I don't know, but I'll try to survive myself. Let's see.
You've come once, twice, and this is the third time. Three times. What exactly did makes you keep coming to this country?
First of all, to provide my life, to save my life here. And when I just escaped from Sudan, planned to come here.
So why do you want to stay illegally then?
I have no choice. How can I don't have
a choice of going back?
Going back to where? To die? Is that the good choice? That's no good choice. To go back to die? What do you prefer? You prefer to stay illegally or to die?
The government need to recognize that Africans will continue to come here to find work no matter what. They are a vital part of the UK workforce, doing the menial jobs no one else wants to do.
I don't know what to say. But you're a real warrior.
Everything.
What a world.
My journey is one of thousands made by people from Africa every year. Like Arik, they dream of a better life. And once in the UK, they contribute to the economy, cleaning trains, sweeping streets, flipping burgers, making our lives easier and simpler. Now the government wants to encourage skilled workers into this country, draining African countries of their professionals. But I think it is these so-called illegals who are desperate to come here and contribute to make a better life from where they came. They will continue to come even if we electrify the seas. Surely there must be a better way of dealing with them than this.
I see.
Right.
Mark Thomas discovers just how easy it is to broker weapons in dispatches after school's arms club next Monday at 8. Next tonight, a household name's most personal film ever. Tony Robinson, Me and My Mum, opens the Trouble with Old People season.